So here we are again. It's August, beginning of August 2013. Show prep time, 11 weeks to the British finals. And this is the bit I hate the most, the early morning cardio. The diet I can do, I'm quite used to doing the diet. I don't mind being hungry. It's kind of mind over matter. But I really dislike getting up early in the morning. I'm not a great lover of cardio, so getting up early to do cardio every morning is the worst part of it for me. But it's also one of the most important parts of it. I don't think you can ever really get properly conditioned without the morning cardio.
Okay, it's still about 7 weeks from the British finals. I've been dieting for 4 weeks now. Nothing much coming through. So today we've come to Pump Gym in Stevenage. We're going to do some back work. My back's normally the first thing to come through, so we're going to see if we can encourage that to happen today.
Training partner or not, are they a help or a hindrance?
Oh God. Right, okay. For me they're a hindrance, all right? The pain in the arse. Simple as this, all right? This is my reason, okay? When I train, all right, people call me the lone wolf. Look, take a look at that. That's not there for no reason. People have told me that's me, okay? The bodybuilder with the wolf's head. They said that's me, that's the way I train, okay? And I love training on my own. Because when I come to the gym, I come to the gym on business and I just want to get in, I just want to get my work done and that's it. That doesn't mean say that I'm rude to anybody. When anybody speaks to me, I'll always be polite to them and I'll talk to them for 10 seconds in between sets, but I will not stand and have a conversation. I will not stand and text people and phone people. I'll go into the gym with one thing in mind, get my work done and get done. After that, I'll sit down, often sit and chat to people half an hour for an hour. You know, well, I'm having a protein shake after. But to go back to your question now, what I found is every time we've had a training partner, they'll do a set and they want to talk about something. I don't want to talk, okay? I don't come here to talk. I've trained with different people. I've found in every pretty much, I mean, they're useful sometimes. If you're doing a heavy bench, you need someone to lift it in. If you're doing certain things, you need people to lift it in. But you don't actually need a training partner for that. You just need to say to some gym, just give us a spot on this, mate. Because I find if you've got a training partner for an hour, I like to try and do about like 30 sets in an hour. If I never had a training partner, that 30 sets will take me an hour and 20 minutes. That's not coincidence, is it? That's because they want to talk and tell me about their wives and girlfriends and how sad their life is. And in the nice possible way, when I'm training, I don't care, all right? I don't care about anything other than my training. That's how selfish you have to be in this sport. If afterwards you want to sit and have a coffee, you can tell me all your troubles in the world and I'll be the most sympathetic man in the world. But when you're training, you know, as I say, lone wolf me, get in, get done, get it done. If you must have a training partner, then find one that's as equally determined as you. If you can find one that won't stand and talk, then yes, they're a help. But I've found in most cases, they're always a hindrance.
If someone is going to compete, what are their first steps in this?
Okay, the first steps are you've got to be big enough. The only way you're going to get big enough is to eat and train properly. The only way you're going to do that is to appoint a coach, someone that knows what they're doing, not your friend in the gym who knows it all and has never competed. You need, I often tell people, you need at least a year of bulking up, some cases two, some cases three. Then when you've got to a decent size, if you've got a good coach, they'll then change your diet and they'll change your training and then you'll start cutting up and then you'll see. The thing I always say to people is don't set yourself a target. Don't set yourself, I've got to look like this by that day. Just take as long as it takes to get as big as you need and then say, right, now I'll start cutting up and when I start looking the part, then I'll choose a show. That's the basic rule of thumb you need to do for it, but you know, there's no shortcuts. Don't think you can watch this and think, right, okay, well, I'll compete next year. Unless you've been doing it for a while, you won't. This is a long-term plan, okay? The amount of people that come to me and think that they can, you know, turn it around in a few weeks, it doesn't happen. This takes a long time to look like this. Ask any bodybuilder that's ever achieved anything and they would say it didn't happen overnight. So the very first step I would say is get the commitment, get the dedication, and then take it from there.
There is one thing that we've not going to cover in the program itself, and that is the use of steroids. And the reason I picked to ask this question is you've said to me that when you've done it, you've only ever done it to protect the muscle that you have.
Yeah.
Therefore, and because we've seen the other programs, your bulk was built by hard work and not by steroid growth.
Absolutely.
And that's why we're not going to cover steroids in this program.
Yeah, yeah.
What would you would still say the same thing, hard work for years and years and years?
I can only advise people, you know, to follow the model that I did. I can only tell you what I did and what worked for me. I don't know if it would work if you were 21 and went on tons of gear. I don't know what that would do to you. Well, I can guess it would probably mess you up completely for your life. I can only tell people the model that I did. I know I was extreme. I trained 22 years drug-free and then decided that I was going to take gear when I competed to, you know, protect what it had taken me 22 years to build, basically. I'm not saying you should all do that, but the basic of it, is the same. You know, you've got to take X amount of time, a decent amount of time, to build the physique you want and then decide what you can do with it from there. That, you know, but I always say this, you know, please, please, build it up drug-free. If you build it up drug-free, you'll keep it. If you build it with steroids, it will go. It'll basically disappear as quick as it came. If you build it naturally, though, it is very easy to maintain. That's why it was a natural step for me to go from, you know, being as big as I was drug-free to going to competition, because, you know, it was already there. If I'd have built it on steroids, then it's a whole different matter. So please, please, build it up naturally, and then we'll decide what we're going to do for you from there. That's the most important thing.
You need to get cardio into perspective, because most of the people you see at the gym run on the treadmill like demented apes. I told you you were going to laugh.
No, you're right. Okay, cardio does not consist of what you said. People racing about and like, doesn't mean you've done your body any better just because your lungs feel like they're going to burst and your heart's beating through your chest and you're bright red and sweating like crazy. It doesn't mean anything. It just means you're stupid, basically, for working that hard. If you're a bodybuilder, okay, low intensity cardio all times, okay? Different people have different ideas about this. I'm not saying I'm the only way to do it, but again, what Eddie taught me, again, what all the good bodybuilders, and I've worked with lots of good bodybuilders, trust me, and they will always tell you the same thing. Martin Stevenson here, I'm not going to go through the list of top quality bodybuilders I've ever taken advice from, but they will all tell you the same thing. The best cardio you can get is get up in the morning and go out for a walk around the park for an hour before your breakfast. Low intensity, you know, a low intensity power walk. That means walking so that you're getting slightly out of breath, but that's it. And then that's the best time to do it. We've gone through this before. In any case, that's the best thing you can do. And if apart from that, the other time is when you finish your weight training, have your protein shake straight after weight training, then do some more low intensity cardio. Get on a treadmill like I do. Just on there, incline treadmill, and again, same pace, so you're just about getting out of breath. Never ever run, never do all of this rowing machines until you're gonna die. That's not cardio, it's fitness work. Great, if you wanna go and be a marathon runner, if you wanna do fitness work, if anything like that's great, go and do it, go do it. But, you know, not for bodybuilding, definitely not, no.
I know most people don't mind getting up in the mornings and doing cardio, a lot of people actually enjoy it, but I'm just not a morning person, mate. I'm very reliant on carbs. If I don't have carbs, I just don't function properly. So the fact of getting up and doing cardio before I've eaten anything at all, it's just not good for me. But it is the best time, because by getting up and doing cardio before you eat anything, you're just burning off stored fats, stored carbs.
We've also done some video with you when you did your legs, and it was particularly to show striations in the legs. Can you talk more about that?
Yeah, legs. First of all, again, I'm going to refer to Eddie. Something Eddie always used to tell me, that used to scream into me when he was draining legs, it was legs win shows. And of all the things he ever told me, nothing was ever more true. Now, your legs, in the winter, you just want to get as much bulk in them as you can. I find it difficult because I've got bad knees. Years and years ago, I used to box, which meant I'd run 6 miles every morning. And that was in the days before they'd invented trainers that had cushioned insoles. I used to, like, you know, run 6 miles in my plimsolls, which pretty much is gonna knacker your knees and your joints and your ankles. So I don't squat, I can't squat because my knees are so bad. And I wrap my knees, but during the winter I will go heavy leg pressing, and just about anything I can find, extensions, hack squats. I can do some squatting on a Smith machine, but basically all through the winter, you've gotta be squatting and press as much as you can like that, just to get as much size in. Again, when it comes to competition time, the judges want to see big legs, but more important, this is the most important thing, okay? This is the thing that the judges will judge on more than anything, and that is the striations in your legs. I've competed against people with bigger legs than me, and I've beaten them because my legs get so ripped. Again, thanks to Eddie. You need to have as much detail as you possibly can in your legs. The only way you're gonna get that is to do the striation training that was showing you, which as you saw is very high rep, very slow, painfully slow. Lots of negative work, and you saw from when I was doing it, this is the important thing, you saw the muscles shaking. Without going too deeply into the science of that, what it is, when you're working the negatives like that, Basically, you're putting microscopic tears in the muscle. Now, the leg muscles are massive, obviously the biggest muscles in your body. So you keep putting microscopic tears in different parts of the muscle. Every time there's a microscopic tear, the muscle shakes. So every time you see that muscle shaking, when you see me doing those, it's another microscopic tear that's going in, which is exactly what I want. And then by the time I finished, you know, my legs are absolutely destroyed. And because then of the diet, which we've, you know, you've seen, your legs then rebuild, and they rebuild with that diet, the microscopic tears repair, and basically they eat all the fat from around the legs. The result is you have these beautiful big legs with fantastic striations, and that's what the judges are looking for more than anything. As Eddie always told me, legs win shows.
I don't find it aerobically challenging. I've been pedaling away for about half an hour now. I think a lot of that is because I had a week pre-diet fitness training. Went away to a camp and did a lot of power walking and swimming and assault courses, tree climbing, things like that. In fact, I've got a small amount, a short bit of footage from that, which I'll let you watch now while I get on with all this.
This is a zip wire challenge, high tree adventure thing. This is the next phase of getting fit. There's a weight restriction on here of 18 stone, but they're gonna let me do it. I'm gonna be up in these trees and coming down a zip wire a bit later on. There's a staff, they're deciding which one's gonna look after me. They're gonna get the short straw, I think. I have to say that the pre-diet fitness and cardio camp was great fun. The tree climbing high wire zip line thing was tremendous. By the time I got to doing it, I had quite a few people watching it. There was a few people doing it, mostly kids, and they were all flying past me. So by the time I came down the zip wire, they were all watching. It was great. The climbing up part was incredibly hard, actually. It made me realise how unfit I was, but the slide down was great fun.
That's the most fun you can ever have with your clothes on, but it scares the life out of you, but it's brilliant, great fun.
Okay, so we're back at Olney Gym, and we've been doing some training this morning, and we're going to talk first about the shoulder work that you did this morning. Now, I've noticed something. You did it in a particular manner.
Yeah, okay. This is what we call an holistic shoulders workout, invented by Eddie Abu, of course, who most of my stuff comes from him. I'm not ashamed to admit it. The thing that Eddie said to me was, holistic means different things in, you know, medicine and things like that, but holistic in bodybuilding means that you attack every part of the muscle from every different angle. And the way that I do it is I first of all attack the front delts because they're tiny little strips of muscle just here, and hit them with six sets, and every set's slightly different, so it basically, you know, stretches and pulls that little front delt in every angle. From there I go to the rear delts, because again it's just like a strip that goes down the back of the shoulder, and again six sets, all slightly different, so that you're pulling it from every angle. And then after that I come to the what we call the medial head, or the middle part of the delts, which is the biggest part. I do those last because that way the front and back are exhausted and the middles have got to do all the work themselves. It's the heaviest part of the workout, and again six more sets just for those from every different angle. And that way then you've done 18 set workout for your shoulders. You split each one of the shoulder, the deltoid heads into their own little world. You've stretched every part of it for every way. That's what you mean by holistic, every part of the muscle from every angle.
So this is particularly different from a normal training session, because you're not doing like a military press and them sort of exercises.
That's right. I mean, again, before I was a proper bodybuilder, when I just did weight training just because I wanted to be, you know, big, shoulder workout would consist of military press, you know, dumbbell pressing, Arnold press, Smith machine press, you know, press everything. And basically just to make your shoulders as big as they can, which is great and it does work, and I've got quite a decent size on my shoulders. If you're going to compete, they don't care, well, they do care how big your shoulders are, but it's not so much about the size, it's about the definition. If you see my show pictures, especially when I do my rear double biceps, you can see each head of the shoulder, each deltoid and the rhomboids, everything just pops out all in one go. So you can actually, my physio says it's like an anatomy diagram. So that's why we do the holistic workout. Off season, yeah, you can do loads of pressing, but when you start getting near showtime, the holistic stuff, high rep, nice and slow, style and form as always is most important, and just absolutely every single head, isolate it, bring it out like that.
I always talk about how highly I rate outdoor morning cardio. This is not just because of the fat burning benefits. If done properly, it can be a time for spiritual meditation and motivation. And I don't mean sitting on your bum in the middle of a field. I mean walking at a good pace and thinking about inspirational things. I always say that the things that inspire me the most are those that love me and are loved in return. And while that's always be true, there are other sources that I draw on too. In my house there's motivational stuff pretty much everywhere, but the three most prominent pieces are not bodybuilding related. This is the first one, from Steve Jobs. It's something that I send to many people. It's brilliant in its simplicity and it conveys a message that I always tell people to believe in. The second piece is by Nelson Mandela. What inspires me about this piece so much is that it's written by someone whose life featured so much suffering and fighting in it, and yet this is the very epitome of positive thinking. So to write something like this when so many years were spent in the depths of despair shows an immense courage and bravery that's rarely seen. The other piece that I love is by Muhammad Ali, who has been my lifetime role model really. Not just because he's the greatest boxer that I ever saw, but
because he stood up for what he believed in, even that meant him going from being the most famous man in the world to nobody. For 3 years, the world was deprived of the greatest in his prime, and he never knew how long the exile would last for, but it didn't matter. His principles were more important. You wonder how many of today's so-called superstars would give up everything like that simply because of an unshakable belief.
This is about the diet side of stuff, about the diet you have for a show preparation. And can you just take us through what it is in a day for your food?
Yeah, I'm going to go through everything that I ate in a day. I've been dieting about nearly 6 weeks now. I'm kind of halfway through, and this is what I've been living on, what I'll carry on living on right up to the end of it. I should start by saying there's many different ways of doing show prep diets, okay? This is the one that works for me. And it's the basis I use for everybody. Obviously, it needs adjusting, as I always say. Everybody's different. You know, you use this as a base and you vary it a little bit for every different person because everybody is different and everyone needs their own diet and their own training plan. But I'll go through what I do anyway. So, first thing in the morning, morning cardio. I will have my morning cardio with a shake. I'm gonna come back to the shakes and tell you what's in them all separately after, okay? But there's a shake with the morning cardio. After that, is my first proper meal of the day, which is 70 grams of oats and 60 grams of whey protein. I also have, I don't have very many fats in my diet because I have trouble digesting fats because of my tummy problems, but it's very important you have essential fatty acids, EFA. So I have this, I have two large tablespoons of that with my breakfast every day. And it's tastes fishy and it tastes disgusting, but I've tasted worse things in my mouth, you know, if you know what I mean. I know, right? Okay. Okay, so that's that. The next meal will be just to make sure that I'm fully loaded with protein before I go to the gym. And I have these, I've started having these things. They're protein vials. There's 50 grams of whey protein in there. Again, tastes disgusting, but you know. So, take that 50 grams of protein. I take that, that'll be actually meal three. It's about 10 o'clock. If I've not got these, or if I just can't stand the taste of it one day, then I will get 12 eggs and just have 12 raw egg whites. That's, believe it or not, sometimes raw egg whites taste better than eggs, but they do the same job. Then on the way to the gym, it's another shake, which I'll go through. This has, you know, a lot of stuff for pre-workout stuff. After training, another shake, which again we'll go through. Then after that, you come to your two afternoon meals. Now, I'll show you the thing that everybody lives on, all right? There. Delicious, isn't it? Dry chicken and green veg. Okay, now most people have broccoli. I can't actually eat broccoli anymore. I'm not a great lover of chicken anymore. After all these years of living on chicken and rice and broccoli, I've kind of had enough of it. So I can probably get one of those down a day. And I've actually moved on to peas now. I can stomach peas. So chicken and peas is one meal. Or as an alternative for the afternoon meals, I will sometimes have one of these. This is a whey protein drink. There's 40 grams of whey protein, nothing else in there. It's just a drink. It actually doesn't taste too bad, that one, so I don't mind that. Or if I feel that I need to eat something and I can't get the chicken down, then I will have this. This is cottage cheese. There, looks disgusting as well, doesn't it? I actually don't mind the taste of cottage cheese. I have this one with pineapple. I'm not a fond lover of fruit in any competition diet, but the thing with pineapple is that it does contain an enzyme that encourages your body to absorb protein. So I don't want a little bit of pineapple in it, and that does that. Next meal, we're now getting on to the evening. This is never changes. It's either salmon or cod loin, and with that, again, some green veg. I just have again, I'm still on peas. One more meal after that, and by now you're hungry. You actually want something that's quite nice, but you know, you can't eat any more stuff that tastes bland. So I actually started having these protein desserts. You can buy these, you know, from the supplement places. The CMP do one. I think USN do one. There's a few of them about. I actually make my own. If you make your own, it's very easy with protein powder, gelatine, and a bit of flavouring, whatever you want. Being on a diet gives you strange cravings. I actually, believe it or not, fancy a bit of ginger sometimes when I'm dieting, which is a bit weird, I know. So I can make a protein dessert with ginger in it, and that solves that problem. And then before bed, which everybody does, a protein shake, and I will sometimes have just a handful of cashew nuts with that, but not always. The idea of the cashew nuts before bed is that it gives your body something to chew on, like basically the fats in the nuts your body can eat, rather than cannibalize the muscles. But that's something you have to get the balance on. There's no point in eating lots of nuts because then the fats will just store on you. But you do want enough just to stop the catabolism coming in. So it's usually just a handful, but that's why I've not put them here, because it's not essential. The only other thing apart from that is water, loads of it. There's these shakes, the four shakes, make up about 3 litres of water together. On top of that, I drink another four litres of water a day. So that's 7 litres a day. I don't drink tap water ever. I don't even drink bottled water anymore now. I use alkaline water. I've got a very expensive water filter that filters tap water, filters all the acid out of it. And the alkaline water, I don't really know the science behind it, but the alkaline water is supposed to help you get ripped up, and it actually tastes a lot better than ordinary water as well. So that's what we do. So there's a day's food. Live like that. That's your day's food for 3 months. Okay, so this is the triceps workout that we're doing. With triceps, believe it or not, the most important thing is safety first. You can see by what I'm doing here, my elbows, that it's very important that you look after your elbows. It sounds silly, you know, you're thinking, you just want to get my tricep big, I want big arms and all of that. But it's very, very easy to damage your triceps where they attach to the elbow. You can see them doing here, just how small the triceps get at the elbow point. If you damage that, you're knackered basically. You're not going to be able to do your shoulder work, your tricep work, your chest work, so many things. So what I tend to do to stop this happening, instead of just lifting massive heavy weights for sets of eight, I go lighter, use negatives obviously, I do the reps nice and slow, and I'm boring, but I always say it, style and form is most important. But if you see here, that's actually quite a light weight, really. I can probably lift, well, I know I can lift much, much more than that. But you see that that's about, I think it's about 30 kilos. I'm lifting it nice and slow, keeping it well under control, not dropping it too quickly. And by doing that, and doing supersets with light weights, it actually gets you a much better effect, and it protects the elbows at the same time. I've seen people do these with elbow wraps and all of that, which will obviously help. But I'm thinking, if you're going to be doing this when you've got to wrap your elbows, what damage could you be doing them? Again, I'd probably go a little bit over the top with safety in a way, because of being older. Younger guys are not susceptible to injury, but I just don't like to take the chance. So, as I say, I do supersets light, as you can see here, rather than doing eight heavy kind of thing. Also, far more important when you're dieting. You know, you've got very little fat on your body for protection or anything like that, so it's very, very important. The other good thing about supersetting is that it helps with shaping and striations. This is very important, let's go into this now. Variation of exercises is very, very important, and this is for this reason. The people, when you think about arms, right, if you ask anybody, they say, you know, I want big arms, so therefore I'm gonna build my biceps. Well, think about the two words. Bicep, bi means two. Tricep, tri means three. Your triceps are actually three heads, the biceps are two heads. And people don't realize that, and that's why the triceps are so important. There are three heads. There are the shorter inner head, the outer longer head, and the head across the top, which I call the horseshoe. I don't know the long words. If you have a look at a perfect tricep, the way that it's done, you'll see all three of those heads are here. Long down the outside, short down the inside, and then the horseshoe across the top. By varying the exercises, and doing them properly, you're going to hit all three parts of that. Why actually, I always say about the mind and muscle connection, I actually visualize something. If you ever see a tuning fork that a piano tuner uses, it's the same thing. It's got two long heads and a big bit at the top. I actually envisage my triceps being the same shape as a tuning fork. And you're trying to bend the prongs of a tuning fork when you're doing the exercise, and then you're trying to snap them out straight. So, by doing it that way, that's what you're going to get. You're going to get all the three heads showing. You're going to get the horseshoe effect, or the tuning fork, as I call it. Come on.
you see that I like doing skull crushes. I do them two different ways. Skull crushes, French curls, call them whatever you want. French press, they've got different names, they're all the same thing. But again, you'll see that I'm doing them very light and I'm doing them with perfect style and form. And I'm using the negatives. Again, not very heavy, but by doing it properly, style and form is massively important. The reason is with your triceps, they're actually very small muscles. We've already said there's three heads. They're three very small heads. They're nowhere near as big as the muscles in your chest and your back and your legs and all of that. So it's very important that you isolate each one of the heads and isolate the whole lot of the triceps. You'll see them doing pushdowns that I try to keep my elbows into the side and everything like that. And by doing them nice and slowly, letting them up slowly, using the negative, it actually really gets some vascularity into the arms as well. You know, the blood's pumping around nicely. So very, very easy. I know I'm boring, I said, so, you know, you'll probably dream about me saying this, you know, whenever I coach people, I say that some style and form is far more important than anything else, but it really, very, really is, so, you know. The other thing is, if you don't get your style and form right, it's very, very easy for the larger muscle groups to take over. What I mean by that is, do you see what I'm doing here? It would be very easy if I didn't have the positioning right, for example. It's very easy for the shoulders to take over. You can see the shoulders are trying to do a little bit here.
Okay, we're recording now.
Okay, so this is the triceps workout that we're doing. With triceps, believe it or not, the most important thing is safety first. You can see by what I'm doing here, my elbows, that it's very important that you look after your elbows. It sounds silly, you know, you're thinking, you just want to get my tricep big, I want big arms and all that. But it's very, very easy to damage your triceps where they attach to the elbow. You can see them doing here, just how small the triceps get at the elbow point. If you damage that, you're knackered basically. You're not going to be able to do your shoulder work, your tricep work, your chest work, so many things. So what I tend to do to stop this happening, instead of just lifting massive heavy weights for sets of eight, I go lighter, use negatives obviously, do the reps nice and slow, and I'm boring, but I always say it, style and form is most important. But if you see here, that's actually quite a light weight, really. I can probably lift, well I know I can lift much, much more than that.
Okay, Kev, I've been snooping around while you've been out of the room, just so you know, and I've noticed in the corner there you've got like sweets, chewy bars, chocolate bars. Can you give us an explanation for that?
Yes, well, the honest and basic explanation is there for my granddaughter. She does love her sugar. I have her 24 hours a week. She comes round and she does love her sugar. She likes sweets, popcorn, everything like that. But there's actually a very, very serious reason why it's there as well. And that is because when you're on a diet like this, there's a very good chance that your blood sugar level is going to drop to a very low level. The way you can tell if your blood sugar level is too low is if you get very hot and very sweaty and you're shaking and you need to pee about every 20 minutes, then your blood sugar is critically low and you need to do something. So that's why that's there. I'll eat a couple of bars of chocolate to get it back up. That's what you need to do. Now, as a precaution, this is something that I do and I would recommend to everybody. These cost a few quid. This is a blood sugar test kit. I'm not gonna do it now, but that's got a needle in it. You just prick your finger, take a bit of blood, put it in one of these strips, and it put it in the machine there, and it tells you what your blood sugar levels are. So you can always keep an eye on your blood sugar levels. The other thing, which is, again, very cheap to buy, very basic, is get one of these, a blood pressure kit. You can take your own blood pressure, very easy to do.
Doesn't hurt every few days just to take your blood pressure and your blood sugar levels just to make sure they're not doing any damage to yourself and that you're quite healthy. If you do that, prevention is always better than cure. But yeah, the sweets are mainly for my granddaughter, but they're also there in case of emergency as well.
Have you seen any things happen to people that have gone low blood, low blood sugar? And you've seen that in people yourself?
I've seen it in people getting ready for competition. I've seen them in the gym where they'll push themselves maybe a little bit too hard, or they'll make the mistake of doing their weight training and then going straight into an hour's cardio, and they're doing the cardio too high in intensity. And basically the body just says, look, I'm sorry, but we can't do this anymore. And that's when the signs come. You'll see them dripping in sweat, and you'll see them keep running to the loo, you know, and you'll see them shaking, and you say to them, look, how are you feeling? They're like, I'm out of breath and I feel dizzy. And then you have to sit them down. And it's the same sort of thing as if you're a diabetic. You have to get some sugar in the body quickly. So I always keep that as an emergency for emergency stuff. And I think a lot of gyms always keep stuff like that, and it's a very good idea, because if the blood sugar level drops, you can be critically ill. So, you know, prevention is better than cure. Just keep an eye on it. Just because you're on show prep doesn't mean you can't actually go out and enjoy yourself now and again. I like to go out for lunch down here, and I've got several places where I can go where the chefs know what I'm doing, and they will prepare me different food off the menu. This is a crayfish salad. There's a tiny bit of sauce on it. It's all fat free. It's just crayfish and green leaves. So that's very healthy. It's all protein. There's no carbs in there. I've finished my carbs for the day. It's just something you can do. It just shows that you can actually enjoy life while you're getting ready for competition.
And we've done a big lot on chest. Can you just go through that?
Yeah, with your chest, I've shown quite a lot of different exercises there. Basically, your chest, you break up into two parts, a bulking section and a cutting up section. I'm lucky, I never carry much fat on my chest. My chest is straighted pretty much all year round. But what I do is, because of that, I make sort of 80% of my work bulking work all year round. It's only when I get near competition that I start putting in more striation work. So just to explain exactly what it is, the bulking work is your bench pressing and your dumbbell bench pressing and the seated chest press and things like that. And I keep them in every week, basically. And then when I get nearer to show, I'll start putting in more things like a couple of pec decks, a couple of cable crossovers and things like that. Things like flies, you can use for bulking and cutting, so you know, put those in every week if you want as well. But you know, generally go for the bulk most of the time, but then we get near to a show, put in the cable crossovers, put in the pec decks and nice high reps, and again, style and form be the most important thing. If you do that, then that will bring the striations out.
Excellent. So what we're going to do, I mean, with this, you're going to see the whole workout we've done today on this.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, we can show everything that we've done there, because, again, you know, because I'm so near showtime, you can see the whole mixture of everything there. I did some bulking work, did a lot of cutting work as well, just to basically hit the chest from every angle, surprise it, shock it as much as you can. We're 2 weeks out from the British finals, so really just got to do anything I can just to keep the muscles tight. That what we've done, so it would work nicely for that, yeah.
Having been to a lot of competition, how would someone actually know that they're ready to compete? I mean, before they even start preparation?
All right, this is going to upset a few people now, but I want to be, you know me, rather be honest than popular. The amount of people that I see that compete have got no right to be on stage. And the reason is because they're deluded. Your question is, how do you know if you're ready? You don't. You can look in the mirror and you can think you look great. You can stick your picture on Facebook and your friends will tell you look great. They don't know crap, all right? Get a decent coach, get someone that's been there and done it, and get someone that will be honest with you. Again, I always go back to Eddie. Eddie would say to me if I was ready, if I wasn't. These days I don't see so much of Eddie, you know, for geographical reasons, and I see Martin Stevenson all the time. The one thing they've got in common, and I love this, is when you're getting ready for a show, and they both use the same phrase, they don't know what they both do, but it's three words that you want to hear, and those words are, you're ready now. When they say you're ready now, then you know you can do it. Both of them probably say it to me about a day before the show. Until then, they'll say, this is wrong, that's wrong. They will tell you straight, and that's what you need. You need a coach who will say to you, look, this is all right, that's not all right, that's got to be worked on, that's got to be worked on. You don't want people that are just going to tell you how great you look all the time, because you don't, all right? You don't look great all the time. You need someone who will be honest with you. Get a good coach who will tell you, and he'll tell you in the first place whether you should even think about competing or whether you should have another 2 years bulking up, as a lot of people come to me and they say, oh, well, you know, I think I can compete, and I say, go back, go and bulk up for 2 years and then come back to me, because they really are that deluded and that far off of it. If you're not sure, ask someone that knows. Not necessarily me, but ask someone that's been there and done it, someone that's competed lots of times and at a decent level, not someone that's done two silly little shows that no one's ever heard of, people that have competed plenty of times at the top level, they'll tell you if you've got what it takes. And listen to what they say. Don't listen to your friends, because you know your friends are your friends. They'll tell you anything you want to hear. Listen to someone that knows. Listen to someone that's been there, and do exactly what they say. If they say, yeah, you can compete in 6 months, do this, then you do that. If they say, bulk up for 2 years, bulk up for 2 years. But do as a coach says. That's the only time you'll know if you're ready or if you're not.
So just by, as you've said quite clearly, just by you thinking you're good enough, it can be a complete delusion.
Absolutely. The worst thing everybody does, I call it the magic mirror syndrome. People look in the mirror and they go, oh yeah, I look great, oh, I feel great and all that. And they probably look good to them. They probably look good to their friends, and they probably look good to a lot of the people in the gym. But the difference between competing in the gym and weight training and anything like that to competition level is not just a different step, it's a different planet. It really is. Competition training and being on stage is a world of difference to going in the gym and chucking the weights about and having a laugh with your friends. It's a completely different world, which is why I say don't be deluded by what you think you see in the mirror or what people tell you. Go to someone that knows and listen to what they say, because at the end of the day, they've been there and done it, so they do know best and you don't.
Again, the key to building a chest, a big chest, is variation of exercises. Everybody wants a big chest. If you've got that, you've got a fantastic base. I know a lot of people that have worked on getting their chest and back right first of all, because they're the biggest muscles. Once you've got that, you can then start adding bits onto it. Most people will do, chest will be the first thing they do. They're going to the gym on a Monday morning or Monday night, and first exercise of the week is chest. And you know, any gym, 6 o'clock on a Monday night, everyone's bench pressing. So obviously that is that important to everybody. It's a very, very large muscle group. It's got to be done properly. And when I say properly, I mean from the moment you walk in the gym. I hate it when I see people walk into the gym and just get straight on the bench and start benching. You're asking for trouble. You know you're going to get injured if you do that. It's very, very important with such a large muscle group as a chest that you go into the gym, that you stretch and that you warm up properly. Very important that you do that. Don't just go and just jump on the bench press, all right? I know that's what a lot of people do, but don't. Just stretch it out. Make sure that your chest is nice and loose and ready for action, and it's got plenty of blood flowing around it before we start.
It's not about the weights, it's what you do with it, right?
Absolutely, yeah. Style and form every time, yeah. What I always say to people is, style and form is the most important. If you can get that right, let's see, he's done easy set, that was 10 very easy. So now if we put the weight up, as long as I get the style and form dead right, then that's fine. If I don't, then I cut the weight back down again. Style and form always.
Once you start on your chest work, I think most people start with bench pressing. Doesn't have to be. The way I always tell people to do it is to build it up. Work out what's going to be your strongest set. When I used to lift very, very heavy, I actually held the gym record, the old gym that I was training at, which was 195 kilos. That was a clean bench press, which was at the time wasn't far off the British record. But we worked out that my strongest set was my fifth set. So we used to just build it up, maybe do the first set for 10 reps for 100 kilos and then a 9 and 8 or something like that, and build it up so that on the fifth set, I was going to be strongest.
Yeah, people often say to me, well, how long have we got to be competing for? I say 5 years. I say 5 years of doing it properly, hard competitive bodybuilding. After 5 years, you should really have reached your potential. You know, if you've got it right in the first place, you're going to your first show only when you're ready for it. This is my fifth and last year. I won 8 UK BFF titles. I won an NAC British Open. The only thing I've not won at the time of filming is the UK BFF Britain. That's what we're getting ready for now. Whether I win that or not, this will be my last year. That's as far as I can go. I'm going to be 55 by the time next season comes around, so you've got to say, right, enough's enough. Your life has to go on, you have to evolve. So I go from this and all I've learned, open my new gym in January, and then take the knowledge that I've got there, give that to other people, let them do all the suffering from now on. That's the best way. Okay, one more.
And you can apply that theory to every chest exercise that you do. Work out when you're going to beat your strongest and make that your heaviest set. So if you think your third, fourth, fifth set is going to be the heavy one, the strongest one. That's when you go for the heaviest weight. There's a myth. Some people are, oh no, well, I'm always going to be at my strongest for the first set because, you know, I'm fresh and I'm not tired and I'm not doing anything. That's nonsense. If you watch any professional sportsman, watch the footballers, they have a proper warm-up. Look at rugby players. They virtually play a game for 20 minutes before they even start. You have to have the body full working order and what I call hit the ground running. So work out what's going to be your strongest set on everything you do. Build up to that on every one of them. Most people, as I said, start with bench pressing, which is fine. You know, I think most of us do that. After that, you then got to, as I say, with me, it was my fifth set. The way I always used to do it when I was building my chest was hit that fifth set as hard as I could. Then after that, do supplementary work to make myself stronger for the next week. But again, apply the build-up, I call it pyramiding way up to do it, so you know which set is going to be your strongest one. And if you do that on each one, actually exhaust every part of the chest. That's what you do, you know. Whether it be, as you can see here, I'm doing a seated chest press, which hits the pecs at a slightly different angle. Everything you do, just build it up, whether you're going to do 3, 4, or 5 sets, work out which one's going to be your strongest one, build it up to that, and really go for it on the big one. If you do it that way, you're going to exhaust every part of the chest. And then what I like to finish off with is cable crossovers and pec decks and things.
Record and then press the space bar to continue.
Again, the key to building a chest, a big chest, is variation of exercises. Everybody wants a big chest. If you've got that, you've got a fantastic base. I know a lot of people that have worked on getting their chest and back right first of all, because they're the biggest muscles. Once you've got that, you can then start adding bits onto it. Most people will do, chest will be the first thing they do. They're going to the gym on a Monday morning or Monday night, and first exercise of the week is chest. And, you know, any gym, 6 o'clock on a Monday night, everyone's bench pressing. So it is that important to everybody. It's a very, very large muscle group. It's got to be done properly. And when I say properly, I mean from the moment you walk in the gym.
Kevan, does it feel nice or is it quite painful when you're having a massage?
It's a bit of both, actually. Emma's incredibly strong for her size. She might look like she's not, but she really does dig in like that. And so it's quite painful at times. But when it's done, it's a terrific feeling because my back's, you know, always tight, you know, because I'm old, basically. And I'm training, you know, when you're training as hard as I am at the moment, it goes even tighter. And you, when you lose body fat, you lose it from around the SI joint, and so that makes it even worse. So this is a necessary thing for me, to have my back loosened up. Emma does it once a week, and it kind of, you know, keeps me going. And also she does my neck from where I broke my neck 30 years ago, that's still a bit stiff, so she does that. And she's also been treating the elbow, because I've got, what is it called, Em?
You have got a cranium bursitis.
I knew that. And so she was treating that as well. So pretty much holding me together, you know. So it's very, very important and very worthwhile.
Yeah, I mean, with your old cranium bursitis at the moment, it's never going to go away at the moment because of the amount of training that you're doing, because you're not capable of resting. So that's just a case of managing it to the best of our ability at the moment, rather than looking for that long-term fix at the moment. So we've just got to help you get through what you're getting through with that.
Yeah.
Would you say this is an important thing to do with anyone doing pre-competition?
I suppose the load that you guys are putting on yourselves, you're elite athletes, and elite athletes have sports massage, don't they? It's a way that they have of preventing injuries and so on. So if you're not, even if you haven't got any sort of injuries, by having the massage, it's giving those really good stretches out into those muscles, into the fascia. helping remove your toxins, and it is supposed to be a prevention for injury as well as being able to sort of help where there is pain involved from old injuries and so on.
Okay, would you still recommend this anyway to someone who is pre-competition?
Absolutely, absolutely. I don't actually think I could get ready for competition without this. I think I'd be in too much pain from my back. And when you're training, you know, there's a simple rule, where there's pain, there's weakness. So if you're in pain, you're not lifting the right weights, often your style and form will suffer because of that as well. So if you're getting it wrong in the gym like that, you're wasting your time. So yeah, this is essential for me that I have this. Obviously, it's probably worse for me because I'm older, but I recommend it to everybody. I really would, definitely.
Okay. I mean, my opinion is that, you know, like I said, you are all athletes. And, you know, whatever sport that people are performing at the top of their game, this is a sort of thing that they will have done regularly. So be it rugby, basketball, you know, track events, everybody will tend to get rubs of some sort to help them through their time of training.
And the reason why I then do it is because she actually massages bigger guys than me. She does the Bedford Rugby Club.
Well, I don't know that they're bigger than you now.
Well, I'm being, you know, humble. But you don't, didn't you do
the diet changes right in the last couple of weeks or week or so. You want to go through that?
Yeah, very important. You're changing train, your training changes. As you get nearer and nearer to showtime, again, different people tend to do it different ways. I'm old school, it works for me, it works for people I coach, and what we do is we just basically start increasing the reps, drop the weight, increase the reps, increase the intensity, increase the amount of negative work, so that the muscles have got more time under tension than ever, even though it's only lightweight. And you saw today from the striation work that we've done on the leg, the way that it works. You see that my legs, the muscles actually shake, the fibres are actually tearing and shaking. And because the diet's changed so much and your carbs are the lowest they ever are, it just brings out all the deep cuts, and that's the way that it works. So your training changes as much as that you start cutting the weight down and increase the reps, increase the intensity and slow down the reps. With your diet, the last couple of weeks, obviously you're on a low carb diet in any case. As you get nearer and nearer, different people do it different ways. Some people like carb cycling, I'm not a lover of that. But the way I like to do it is step down the carbs more and more and more, so that by the last sort of the last few days when we're doing what we call carb depletion, which would be about days 6, 5, and 4 out from a show, my carbs would be 50 grams per day. And I never go below 50 grams. Again, not everyone agrees with that, but I never go below 50 grams of carbs per day. My protein stays the high, the same as it is all the way through. But that goes down to 50, and then 2 days before, then I'll start increasing the carbs again. And then the effect of that is that where your muscles are carb depleted, you're just putting carbs in for the last couple of days, and the carbs go straight to the muscles. The muscles suck in the carbs and expand out. And of course, what with that and your water depletion, which is something else I'm just going to talk about briefly, you find that the muscles go drier, firmer, and fuller, and that's why you look best on stage. With the water depletion, very briefly, as I already told you, I drink about 7 litres a day. I step that down nearer and nearer to the showtime. I will have on the Friday, I'll cut it down to 4, and on the Saturday it'll just be 1 litre. And then about 6 o'clock on the Saturday night, then there's no more water then, so I come off stage and all I live on is dry white wine, which is a very good diuretic that keeps draining the water out of me. The other, the best two things that you can take for water depletion is dandelion root and vitamin C. And what I do is, as I start having less water every day, I start having more vitamin C and dandelion root every day. And the combination of the two is less water going in, more coming out, and then the dry white wine for like best part of 24 hours before you go on stage. You go on stage absolutely dry, totally dehydrated, and your muscles very full and very hard, and you look great, you look very vascular. There's other little tricks you do to bring the veins out on stage. I'll tell you a trade secret that you'll laugh at, that what most of us guys take before we go on stage is a Viagra tablet. Doesn't have the effect you think it would, because it just doesn't. You've not got the energy for that, but it makes all the veins pop out. So you'll normally find the guys who go on stage totally dehydrated, muscles very full, veins popping because of the Viagra. And that's why when you see us when we come off stage, we look like we're going to collapse. And what we usually do is just go and sit down somewhere with a couple of litres of water, and I normally have some diarrhoea just to get some electrolytes back into the body. Because you know, you only look like that on stage for a few hours. And then, you know, the next day you look completely different once the water and everything starts going back in. So it's quite an art to get it spot on. comes back to what I always say, get a decent coach, get a coach who can get you spot on. If you get it right, you look amazing today. If you get it wrong, you're not going to look so good. But if you can get it dead right by doing all those things, if you've got a coach that can look after you and do it, then you know, you're going to get the result and you're going to look fantastic.
It's now the middle of September. I've been dieting for about 6 weeks. I'm about halfway through now. I've deliberately not done any video cardio logs since day one. I'm hoping that you can look at this now and see a major change in my face. The reason for not doing the logs is so you can see just what the diet does to you. Obviously, it rips up your body, but it's going to rip up your face as well. You can't spot reduce, it'll take fat from all over your body. I've still got about another 5 weeks before the British final, so I'm going to look a lot worse yet. But on the other hand, I'm quite pleased with where everything's coming through. I'm doing a show this coming Sunday as a warm-up practice. I've not been on stage since November last year. I'm doing the Midlands Championships in Birmingham. I won it last year, so I'm going to try and win it again this year. And getting a bit of practice, getting my posing a bit better for this year. So all in all, things are going quite well. Got a lot of support from a lot of very good friends. That's been massively helpful because the diet is beginning to hurt now. As I say, there's still quite a bit of a way to go yet. I'll do the show Sunday now, to take a couple of days off, and then get back on it again. But the main reason for me doing this video log today is, as I say, to show you just what it does to you. I mean, it's first thing in the morning, it's about 7 o'clock in the morning right now, and I never look all that good first thing in the morning in any case, but I'm hoping you can see the difference, you can see what it does to me, because if you're going to do a show, it's going to do exactly the same to you, so please be very, very aware of that. I will be back again soon.
That's right. Turn to the side, best side, side chest. Where's the rear? Drag a calf, double bicep. That's right. Turn to the side, best side, rest of the body. Side to the side. And face the front. Face the front. Both hands behind your head. Okay, relax. Please, relax. 32, could you come down this end for me, please?
Put on the
28, 36, 33, change. And then 34, 33. Okay, come back. That's great. Hold on a second, guys. Okay, that's great. Turn to the side, best side, side chest. Face the rear. That's the rear, showing the calf and the bicep. That's great. Turn to the side. Best side, rest of the body. And face the front. And you have to do that. shine.
Thank you. Steve, everybody. Guys, the magazine's two poses. First pose.
Come down a bit.
Second pose.
That's it, leave it there. Leave it there.
Okay, can we get the winner on his own, please, for the magazines? Did everybody see the women's bodybuilding show before earlier? Well, the judges have decided that the lady was that good.
Okay.
Silvana.
Kev.
She was that good. 10 seconds, Eric.
Sorry.
She was that good that they asked her to come back for the overall in the show. For the overall in the show.
Kerry, 30 seconds, please.
30 seconds for this, mate. Yeah.
Oh, just pop it, leave off stage. Get right.
Yeah, we thought we'd just come outside and do something out here, because one thing that I noticed when we made the second documentary with you, Kevan, was that the effect this whole thing has, this whole process has on families. And is there anything you can say to the families about this and to the guys that are going to be doing these competitions to show, you know, it is a really grueling and it can be an emotional journey for people?
I think this is a very, very important subject, and it's good that we're doing this in an environment away from the gym and even away from the kitchen, away from everything that you might associate with getting ready for a show. Probably best if I'm brutally honest and blunt here, and I apologise in advance if I use any bad language. A show diet typically lasts 3 months. Some will do it for slightly less than that, some will do it for more. In a nutshell, during that time, the athlete that's getting ready for competition will turn into an arsehole. I'm sorry, I can't put it any more politely than that, but they will. This is because of two things, the diet and the tiredness, basically. You've seen elsewhere that we've talked about the diet, and I've mentioned in that I typically would go from 400 grams of carbohydrates a day down to 100 grams. So imagine if someone takes away 3/4 of your food that you eat on a normal day, how your body is going to react to that. I mean, it's not 3/4 of your food, but it's 3/4 of your energy food, your carbohydrate, and that's the stuff that your body relies on. So you've got that taken away from you. But then in addition to that, you've got extra training. Okay, most people, you know, train 3 or 4 times a week. When you get ready for a show, you all of a sudden your weight training goes up to 5 times a week. Your cardio, which I do no cardio off season, goes up to an hour before breakfast, and then again maybe 45 minutes in the afternoon. So I've had 3/4 of my energy food taken away, and I've kind of trebled my workload. That's going to have an effect. That's going to affect you physically, and it's going to affect you mentally. It's going to affect the way you look. I mean, you can see me now. You've seen me on programs before. I've been dieting about 6 weeks. You can see I look about 10 years older. That gets a lot worse by the time the show comes around. By the time that the show's finished and you start eating again, it comes back on. Your face kind of gets back to normal quite quickly. But you've got to remember, when you're dieting, you can't spot reduce. If you're losing fat, your body will take you from every single place on your body, and that includes your face. So you will automatically look a bit pale and drawn and a bit old. Because of the diet, you're going to be tired all the time. You're going to get physical changes, and you're going to get mental changes as well. Simply because you have to realize most of the carbohydrate that you have every day actually goes towards brain function. If your carbohydrate is that much lower, then your brain function is not going to be so good. You can't concentrate on things so well. And you actually become very short with people. You become very short with your work colleagues, with your family and your loved ones and all of that. So this is what you've got to expect. If you're going to stick with your partner through this whole thing, you need to know from the start what it's going to be like. And again, I'm going to be very blunt and tell you what you're going to have to do and how it's going to have to be for you. You're going to have to learn to bite your lip quite a lot, because there will be times when your partner will say something and you'll want to have a row about it, but there's no point, okay? It's an argument you can't win. So you're going to have to do that. You're going to have to learn a lot of the time just to stay quiet. You're just going to have to learn that there will be times when he doesn't want to talk or she doesn't want to talk, and they're best left on their own. So it's going to be difficult, but the important thing is that you are supportive all the way through, because it's an emotional journey. You feel at the time, a lot of the time, you feel very lonely, and the person that's closest to you, you probably take it out all on them, but at the same time, you're the, they're the one that you need to support you. So it's a horrible situation. You know, people ask why we do it, and I don't really know, but we do, and that's what it's going to be like for you. It is very difficult to maintain a sensible relationship, you know, while you're getting ready for competition. I know of a lot of people that have broken up because of it. Personally, it's something I've always done on my own. I've never, ever got ready for competition and had a serious girlfriend while I'm doing it, because I don't think you can do it. The thing is, I've never met anyone I think could stay the distance. And when I say stay the distance, that's a very important point, okay? Don't think that the day they've done the show that you go out for a pizza that night and they're better the next morning. That won't happen, all right? You'll have typically 3 months before the show, and then after that, it can take anything from a few weeks to a couple of months for the athlete to get back to normal. Me personally, it takes me about a month. Yeah, fine, physically, you know, I go out and eat well. I always put on a lot of weight straight after a show. I did Mr. Universe in 2010. I came back from that, I put on 2 stone in 10 days. So physically, I was fine. But mentally, it takes a lot longer to get over it, because show prep takes you to some dark places. So it takes a while to get over it. So the thing I'm saying is about staying the distance is stay with your partner all the way through it, support them all the way through it, but then maybe allow for a month after as well. And this is the most important thing. You've got to stay with them for about a month after and let them get their lives back to normal. And then if you do that, I would think that the rewards would be well worth it. Personally speaking, as I've always ever done it on my own, but if I could ever find anybody that would stick with me for 3 months of a diet and then the fourth month of me getting over it, I think I would like go way over the top in showing my gratitude, because we do realise what we get like. We do realise the people that we become when we're getting ready for competition. When you come out the other side of that, we tend to overcompensate to say sorry. I know that I certainly would do so. Stick with it and the rewards are worth it at the end. I think I'd like to round up this piece, though, actually speaking not to the partners, but to the athletes, or maybe to the two of you together. I'm going to say that what this is about is damage limitation, okay? I'm speaking to the athletes now. It's very important that you do this for the right reasons, okay? Do it for yourself. Do it for the people that love you. Don't do it for validation or justification of your lifestyle. If you want to do it so that you can put pictures on Facebook every day of a plate of broccoli and say, look how hard I'm dieting, this is all the broccoli I'm eating, then you're doing it for the wrong reasons. If you want to do it so you can post on Twitter what a great workout you've had, you're doing it for all the wrong reasons, okay? If your motivation is just to show everybody how clever you are, you're doing it for the wrong reasons and you probably won't do very well in your show. If your motivation is to look at the person in the mirror and say, right, that is the best I've ever looked in my life, that is the best I could possibly look right now, then you're doing it for the right reasons. If you do need validation, if you do need justification, don't do it by getting someone to like you on Facebook. Anyone can do that, all right? Any idiot can just do that. If you really want, if it's important to you that people are impressed with what you've done, tell them to come to a show. If they really mean it, if they're your real friends, if they really do care about you, they will come to a show. They will come to a show and they'll sit in the crowd. And if you have done the work and if you look good, they will stand and applaud you. And I'll tell you something now, this is very important. Bodybuilding crowds are the best crowds in the world. If you go to a bodybuilding show, you will see people that have never been on stage before who nobody in the crowd knows, and they will be up on stage and the crowd will stand on their feet and they will clap and applaud and cheer these people, even though they don't know them, even though they've never seen them before, for one simple reason. The bodybuilding crowds are very knowledgeable. They know the amount of work that goes into it. So if you really want to know if you've done well, get these people to go to a show, see what kind of reaction you get, then you're doing it for the right reasons.
We've just done the posing routine, the set poses. Do you want to just go through that for us?
Yeah, you always have what they call is the compulsory poses. You start off with the quarter turns, the four quarter turns. That's where the judges are looking for the depth and shape of your body. They're very important, the quarter turns, actually. You get a lot of marks for those, and most people don't practice them anywhere near enough. Then after that, the compulsory poses, which everybody knows, the front double biceps, front lat spread, side chest, rear double biceps, rear lat spread, side tricep, and abs and thighs. And in some federations, the most muscular pose, UKBFF don't have that, but we'll tend to hit it anyway when they tell you to relax, just to sort of try to impress the judges a bit more.
What are you looking for? What are the judges looking for in those poses? Is there something? I mean, the thing that I'm thinking of is, if they're scoring you on that, you need to make it look the best possible way you can.
Yeah, each one of the poses, they are primarily looking for what it says, but there's a bit of a catch in it, really. For example, they'll say, front double biceps pose. So you think, well, I want my biceps to look fantastic, so that's what they're looking at, which they are, but they're also going to be looking at your legs. They look at your legs in every single pose. That's why your legs are the most important part. Eddie always taught me, one thing he always taught me, I'll never forget, probably because he used to shout it in my ear every training session, bless him, was legs win shows. That's always stuck with me. So whatever pose you're doing, they will look at your legs, whether it be your side chest, they'll be looking at your legs. From your rear, they'll be looking at your hamstrings, everything, they're looking at your legs. But primarily, it's what they say, front double biceps, the lat spreads, and the side chest, but always, they're basically looking at the whole body, not just the bit that they're talking about.
Okay, that's great. Is there anything more you can tell us that you would suggest to people to do with these? With
practice, posing, yeah, practice. Practice like you can't believe. A lot of people think it's the easy part of it, you do all your hard work in the gym. Posing is as hard as doing two workouts. When I'm getting ready for competition, for the last 2 weeks before the show, I would have posing practice at the end of every workout. So it's a good time to do it because obviously you're knackered from just doing your workout. But if you can get through a posing practice for 10 or 15 minutes then, that sets you up well for when you're actually on stage because you're going to be a little bit fresher. But posing is so important that you really do need to practice it every day. As I say, I do it every day for 2 weeks before. A lot of people do it a lot more longer than that, but it's very, very important, yeah.
Okay. And going on from there, let's go on to the routine you've done. We just actually filmed you doing a posing routine. Do you want to tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, different people's opinions are divided on this. Personally, I think that the judges have 99% made up their mind long before you ever see the posing routine, the free posing routine. Other people would disagree and they said the free posing is very important. I don't actually think it is. I still make sure that I do a good free pose and I get my music specially mixed by a good friend of mine called Paul Kemmel. Always has always done me special mixes so that I know that my music will be unique and different to everybody else's. When you do your free posing routine, you highlight you accentuate your good parts. So I always, shove my back and my legs and everything like that as best I can. And as I say, most people probably put too much emphasis on it, but at the same time, you can't really, I suppose, you can't put too much emphasis on everything. You want all your compulsories to be spot on, you want your quarter turns to be spot on, and you want your free posing to be spot on as well. Even if they've judged it by the time it comes on, you still want to give the best possible account of yourself so that, when you're looking at the show video after, you can turn around and say, that's the best I could have done. And regardless of placing, like I always say to people, regardless of where you place, if you've done the best you possibly can and looked the best you ever looked, what more can that, you can't do any more than that, so that's what you've got to do.
Okay, this is an unscheduled video log because 5 days before the British finals, I woke up to find that I've got another hernia. I've had so many in my life from my tummy troubles that I've been had about the last 30 years. Here's a still shot of what it looked like when I woke up on Tuesday morning. You can see exactly, it's like a lump hanging out of my tummy. Went straight away to see my doctor. He's a friend of mine, his name's Imran. We've been friends for years because he's always supported me through my bodybuilding career, and in return for that, I actually wrote him his diet and did his exercise plan when he was a little bit overweight. He's been brilliant and he suggested that I get this thing. It's like a girdle and I've been wearing it ever since. Morning, noon and night, I've been training it, been sleeping it and everything. It's actually worked really well. You see what it looked like in the still. This is what it looks like right now. You can see that the lump is virtually gone. I've not been able to train my abs all week. I'm hoping that once they dehydrate, they're going to come through a little bit better, but obviously it's not ideal preparation. But the lump's nearly gone. Imran said it might just pop out again at any minute. It's one of those things, I can't do anything about it, so I had to change my posing routine and everything.
The only problem that we've got is where the hernia's being pushed back in, it's created all this internal bleeding in my old laparotomy scar. I'm hoping that doesn't get any worse and that, that it'll go away, but we'll have to wait and see on show day. We'll have to just get a very good lot of fake talent to cover it up. But we're going to be okay.
This is the glamour of being a bodybuilder. It's on the way to the British finals now. It's up for the motorway services. Everyone knows having a burger and nice dinner. I've got a baby rice and protein powder in the boot of my car. That's the way it is. That's how glamorous this is. So just think about that before you take it up, alright?
Let's go. Double biceps. Lat spread. Side chest.
Face the rear. Double biceps. Hit the pose, please. Let's go. Hit the pose, please. It's not to your advantage. Relax. Triceps. And face the front, abdominals and thighs. Relax, return to your places. And they are Alfie Noda, Steve Castle, Ronnie Orr, Ian Pradlock, Leszek Jagla, and Kevan Wilson. All right, let's go. Double biceps. All right, let's spread. Relax. Side chest. All right. And face the rear. Double biceps. Lat spread. Lat spread. Triceps. Relax, face the front, abdominals and thighs. All right, relax, a little music. Okay, relax, and if you go to the back of the stage, we'll call you in a moment for the top six. It's very, very close, and that's why it's taking a little bit longer than normal. It's very close. And it's no good to give the result and then alter it afterwards. So they're checking, they want to make sure the result is as is. Dennis? Our vice president, renowned gentleman, present the trophies. And in sixth place, we have Kevan Wilson. Let's hear it. In fifth place, we have Ronnie Orr. In fourth place, we have Ian Proudlock. In third place, we have Steve Castle. Your runner-up, Lise Giagla. And your winner, and over 50s champion for 2013, Alfie Loda.
Top two will be invited to the British finals. I could ask Nicholas to take the third place trophy. The last year is myself. To number 44, Nick Hunter. Second place. Number 46, Kevan Wilson. On the furthest prospect, he's Kevan on the furthest prospect. And our Masters Over 50 champion, 2013, Abbas Samur. Bodybuilding kit, thank you.
Okay, we're pretty much at the end of what we're doing. So how's the year gone for you? And what are your last thoughts?
Yeah, the year's been good, actually. It was always going to be my last year of competition. And what's happened this year has proved to me that was a good decision to make. You know, basically, won the Midlands Championships for the second year running. That was great. That was probably the best fun that I had all year. There was nine of us in it, and it was top quality guys. And to win that was fantastic. I did that on 6 weeks prep, which was great. And then 4 weeks after that, I did the British Finals, and I can honestly say I was in the best shape of my life. I think that's personally, I think it's the best I've ever looked. Most people have said to me, "Yes, that's the best you've ever looked." And I placed sixth, which I'm not complaining about. I think the top six in the British Finals could have gone really in any order. It was really that close. So no complaints, but I don't think I can actually look any better than that. As I'm getting older every year, I'm going to be 55 at the beginning of next season. I don't think I can look any better than I did for this year's British Finals. If that wasn't good enough to win it this year, then I'm never going to win it. So that kind of puts a lid on that. And then I did the Stars of Tomorrow just to try to finish the career with a win. You saw what happened in that. I never complained about judging or a result in my life. And I have this saying that once you've competed, whether you win or come last, the next day the show's history. That's the way that I feel about it. So as far as I'm concerned, it was forgotten the next day. And I tried to find a positive in everything. The positive that I found in that was, for the purpose of what we've been doing this whole movie for, is to let people know what it's like if you're gonna compete, be as educational as we can. And I've had a couple of people contact me and say, I've seen the video from Stars of Tomorrow, and I've seen the picture from Stars of Tomorrow, and it's such a travesty of the way they placed you second that it's really made me think seriously about whether I want to compete again. And, which is a bit of a shame, but the positive is it makes people realise that you can do all that I've done. You can do all the dieting, you can do all the training, you can get everything right. You can see, you've seen throughout this movie just, how hard I work to get everything right. And you can really get in the best shape of your life. You can be, in everyone's opinion, the best shape of your life and the best on stage. Doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to win. Some people are not strong enough mentally to handle that. Some people will come away from there, destroyed. And the mental part of this is very, very important. We talked about recovery. You can see, it's a couple of weeks since that show. I've put on about a stone since then. I've got another stone to put on in the next couple of weeks. So physically, I'm recovering quite quickly. My face is looking almost human again. A couple of weeks' time, that'll look a lot better. And mentally, I'm recovering very well too. I'm sort of making up to people that have been supportive throughout the whole of the show prep thing. I know one guy. He when he came out the other side of his show prep a couple of months after, he took his girlfriend to Bora Bora and proposed to her, which was fantastic. I've not done anything as crazy as that. I've been taking a few people out for dinner to say thank you, which has been great. Physically and mentally I'm recovering well. But to go back to what I was saying, if you're not mentally tough enough to accept the fact that, in bodybuilding is that the decisions are often political and many times they'll be judging that nobody will agree with. If you're going to be on the wrong end of that, if you're not tough enough to handle that, then you really do need to think twice about it. The people that have spoken to me about it and decide whether or not they want to compete next year, it's going to be my job really to not convince them that they should compete, but to convince them to believe in themselves again. That's what I'm going to do, and that's my future now. And I'm going to be doing that with this place.
I was actually going to ask you, we're actually in a building. So you brought me to a building site. Can you tell us why we're here? Well, I know why we're here, but you can tell the people why we're here.
Yeah, this building site, which it is at the moment, is going to be my new gym. I'm going to take you around and show you around. We'll have a walk around and I'll show you what we're going to do. This is a pile of rubble that we're going in the skip today. We'll start from the beginning and see what it's going to be like. Okay. You've got to try and work with me now. So this is the entrance here, and we're going to have the big reception area here. That's going to go right around there where we've got these these bits that are all going, and we've already started getting some equipment in. There's going to be a big reception area. We've got this here. This is a dedicated cardio area. As you can see, it's caged off. People just want to come and do their cardiovascular work. They'll come into there. They don't have to see anybody that's going to be out here. This is the big gym floor, which is going to be divided into two sections for one for male weight training, one for female weight training. The women will be allowed to use the men's stuff. The men won't be allowed to use the women's stuff. I'll take you up here now. This is going to be a studio. We're going to have this all mirrored out so people will be able to come here to practice their routines or dancing or anything like that. This is going to be a women's only room. This is where you're going to be, where it's going to be women only. No men will be allowed in here. Again, we've got to do it out here, but this is going to be for women only. So again, girls can come in here. They haven't got to speak to anyone else. And I'll take you around now and show you the changing room. This is going to be eventually the male changing area. Then you're going to come through here. This is going to eventually be the female changing area. And then we're back out here to the cardio part. So as you can see, we've covered pretty much every aspect of the sport. And that's it now. This is my future, to give my knowledge to people and bring them in here and get other people ready from now on. I don't have to do any more dieting. That's the best part of it. Yeah.
So this is it now. Are there any people, there's a few people we'd like to just thank, because obviously we've been helped along the way by making this.
Yeah.
So I just thought I'd ask you about that.
There's a lot of people I should thank, really. There's been a lot of people involved in the show prep that I should thank, but I won't bore everyone by going on with a list of names. But two people I do want to thank. First of all, Eric Guy, who does all the show videos and photos that you've seen us using here. Eric does all of those, and he very kindly said we can use it in this DVD. So thanks, Eric, much appreciated. And the other place, Only Health and Fitness, Martin Stevenson and Kerry have been absolutely fantastic, been fantastically supportive, very helpful. I don't see so much of Eddie these days, but Martin has been great with, advising me in my show prep and posing and things like that. So they're the two people that I want to thank, Eric Guy and Martin Stevenson at Only Health and Fitness.